Hi there. One of the things I've had a lot of fun with just recently is photogrammetry. I've played around with it before, but I found it to be much more successful recently, possibly because I've got a slightly better camera in the phone that I'm using to do it, but also because I found a very good workflow for just creating the initial images that you need to process into these objects. So you can see that one of the advantages to photogrammetry is you can very quickly create a textured 3D model that will be very useful in your scenes. It may not be the central item in your scene, but there can be a lot of work around adding the decoration in your, for example, an architectural scene. So little things like these objects on the screen now would be very useful to put on shelves and things like that. And they're actually very easy to make and don't take very long at all. So let's get into how to do the photogrammetry. So photogrammetry is basically using a tool which takes photographs of objects that have been taken at various different positions around the object, hopefully showing much, if not all, of the geometry of the object. And it then takes those still images and works out where each point in those images are by looking at the objects themselves, the images of the objects themselves, but also the surrounding. So it is important to not have, for example, a completely white or dark surrounding. You need something around it so that the tool that does the photogrammetry work itself can see essentially parallax, so it can see how far from the camera each point is. So the starting point is to sample your images. Now, typically what you do is you take a camera, it could be a phone or whatever, you put your objects out somewhere and you start taking photographs. And normally you would have to take at least 30 or 40 photographs, if not more. And the more you take, the more accurate the ultimate photogrammetry model is going to be. One of the other things to consider is you're better off with very even lighting, not strong lighting coming from one place. So typically it's better to do it outside unless you've got a good studio to do it in, and also to make sure it's done on an overcast day. I'm in the UK, so that's probably about 90% of the days in the UK. If you need to do your photogrammetry, come here. So rather than taking individual photographs, which can take a lot more time, so what I did was I just sampled a video. And you'll see very often the objects drift off screen. I've just put a bit of cardboard down and I've lifted them up a bit so that I don't have to crawl around on the floor. But you can see here is me just taking a video of the objects. I'm making sure I go all around them, get low, and at least once or twice go up high so we can see down onto the object. So that allows me to sample the maximum amount of the objects. Having done that, I then took the video file into my computer, and I very much found that for a Windows computer anyway, Media Player Classic was one of the best programs to use, but I'm sure if you're not on a Windows PC or you may have other tools, but the reason I liked using this tool for the next element is that I can just press Alt-I and it saves. If I do it now, it allows me to save an image from the frame that I'm in, and it also adds a unique file name to each image, which is obviously related to the frame number or the time at least. So I can just quickly scan through the video, and I've got this set up to go forward about half a second. Alt-I, take another frame, scan to the next half a second, Alt-I, take another frame. And I can just quickly do that. You can even set this up with some video tools where you can just say sample a frame every half a second or whatever, set it going, and it will just do that for you. I prefer to choose the individual pictures because otherwise you'll get quite a few where your camera wasn't pointing in the right place, etc. Whereas being able to just very quickly take a video and not worry too much, as long as you're mostly targeting the objects that you want, then it's just great. It just makes it an awful lot easier. So having done that, you end up with a folder that contains all these images, and that's the raw data that we need. So I created 81 photos, which sounds like a lot, but it's actually very quick and easy to do. And then I go to a tool called Meshroom. So I'm just going to say new for a minute. I'll put a link to where you can download Meshroom in the description below. Once you're in the tool, it works with sort of a node system. And generally speaking, I haven't found any need to change any of these nodes. The only ones that you might possibly want to play with is that you can set your specific camera specifications in here if you want to, or allow the tool to work it out itself. And then under depth map, you can see each of these items, and we'll see how that works in a minute, has a different effect. Under depth map, there's a downscaling option. Generally, the defaults will work fine. As I spend more time with Mesh Mixer, I will get to know what each of these things can do. I have found there are a few things you can change to make it sort of brute force, more difficult scan. Once you've got your images, you can just grab them and drop them into here. Now these are higher res images, so they take a bit longer to process. So I'm going to go to this folder, which is one I used to produce that dragon model. See, there it is, just sat on a garden table, 51 images, which is a good number. And essentially, once you've dragged the images in, the next step is simply to click start. I will start it, but it will also then say you need to really save it. In this case, I'm going to continue without saving. If you're using very large images or you're doing a lot of detail, this can take an hour or more to do. I think for me, it usually took about 20 minutes or so, but obviously it only has to do this once. And it's going through and analyzing, and it tells you what it's doing. So it's initialized the camera already, and what it's doing right now is feature extraction. So you can see it's about halfway through feature extraction at the moment. So it's obviously looking for items on here that it's gonna be able to recognize. So it might be his eye, some of his toes and so on, as well as things in the background, like this pot back here and this white planter here. And it's trying to say, right, through a number of images, can I see, for example, his eye in multiple images? Bearing in mind, each image will be slightly different because they're all from a slightly different angle. So that's what it's trying to do, is tie them up. If you like, it's putting a point saying, right, this is point number one, the eye. So if I go to a different picture, oh look, there it is again, so it's here in that picture and so on, and going through. Once it's done that, it then moves on to what it's calling structure for motion, and it's saying, well, I know which in each of these images is an eye, but it's in a different position with each one, and how much has that changed, and how has it changed relative to other things? So that starts to give it an idea of scale and position. So it knows nothing is moving in the scene, and there's another important point that you really don't want trees waving or cats walking by and that kind of thing while you're doing this. Otherwise, that's going to cause some, or may cause some problems. You want everything to stay where it is. And that can be a problem if you're trying to scan a person, for example. They do need to stay still. I'm planning to scan some pets, but somehow I've got to get them to stand perfectly still. However, with the video approach, it's literally just 20, 30 seconds or so, and you'll get enough to create some model from them. So we'll see how that goes. If that works well, I'll upload some images of that. So that's what I think the structure for motion is doing. And essentially it's recreated the geometry at that point. Now the dent scene, it's actually creating, rather than geometry, it's actually creating a point cloud. So it's creating little dots that it knows what color those dots are, and it knows where they are in the scene from a geometry standpoint. It creates this depth map and depth filter. I'm not entirely sure why it does that. It may be that they're used for other things, because you can see some of the nodes connect to the next node and some of them connect to further nodes on. So they're obviously used for different things. And then meshing, that's where it really creates the geometry that we're going to use in Blender. Mesh filtering, so obviously there's a certain amount of noise because of the estimates that are being made, and so this is just smoothing that noise out a bit, I guess. And then finally we have texturing, which is where it's basically sort of UV unwrapping the model that it's got and taking pieces from each of these images. And so in the case of the eye, it'll select one or more of the images that contain a picture of the eye, and it will associate an appropriate point in the UV map with that part of the geometry. So I'm going to stop it here. It's still under feature matching at the moment, and I'm just going to load in the one that I've already done. So you can see it's exactly the same thing, but you can now see there's something over here. Controls are somewhat similar to Blender. It usually produces it at a very strange angle. It doesn't matter too much, but you can see what I was saying. So all of these little camera symbols are where I've taken an image, which Meshroom thinks is a photograph, which sort of is a photograph. And if you hold the middle mouse button down, you can recenter and so on. So you can see this is the point cloud, essentially. So just little dot, but I can load the model. So I'll just click that there, and I've turned on solid. And what I can do is reduce the size of those points, and I'll reduce the size of my cameras a bit as well. And now you can see the model that it's created, as well as a certain amount of the background. And as I said, it's important that there is some background that it can recognize. Further than a certain point, and obviously the background's becoming blurry because the camera is focused on this object, and therefore it struggles to really recreate much of that. If you had a smaller aperture and a longer focal length, it would probably create much more of it. I've certainly had it do that before. So once you've done that, there's nothing more to do in Meshroom. So just to reiterate, you sample your photos out of your little video, you drop the photos in here, and you click start. If there's a problem, it will stop, and it will hopefully give you a bit of an idea of what the problem was. It will stop on one of these. But generally speaking, I found it to be pretty good. And this is a free piece of software, by the way. I know there are much better paid applications available, but I have a bit of an issue with that when there are perfectly good free applications like Blender and like Meshroom available. But as I say, as long as you saved the original file, as I said, this will have now created the geometry and texture geometry that you need. So we can close that. I'll discard the changes. And I'm going to go to a new general Blender instance. And we're going to say File, Import. And we're going to import an OBJ. So under Preferences, make sure that Import, Export, Wavefront OBJ format is enabled. It may already be, but you will need that for this exercise. So we'll go to File, Import, OBJ. Now here are my folders, and here is my Dragon one. Source is where I put my photos, but it's created a folder called Meshroom Cache. So we'll go in there, and you will find models in here. But the one you really want is this texturing model. And if you go into one of those folders, so let's try this one, and you can see there's an MTL, but the one we want is the textured mesh OBJ. So we'll import that, and it may take a little while. You can see I've got a little black square here. Eventually that should get some numbers in it. And there we go, there's the file. And you can see there's my model. So the first thing I generally do, go into orthographic mode by pressing 5 on the num key, and then just start to straighten the model up a bit. You can also go object, set origin, origin to geometry, and that will make it work a little more predictably. As I said, they are typically at strange angles. I don't know why specifically, but it's fine. It's easy enough to correct in Blender. And I'm using that green origin line there as my baseline. So that's a good starting point. So I'm now going to look from above. By the way, in the case of this particular model, we've currently got 167,000 vertices, which isn't massive, but it's sizable. There's 1/3 of a million faces. So we're now going to press tab and go into edit mode. Make sure you are on wireframe view. Press C to get the circle select. And I'm just going to make it just big enough to enclose my object. This is just a quick way to get rid of a lot of the unwanted geometry. And then I'm going to middle mouse button to deselect that area. So everything is selected apart from everything under that area. Just press X and delete vertices. So that's got rid of a lot of it. Come out of edit mode for a minute and I can see my object a bit better. Straighten him up a little bit. Back into edit mode, and we'll just select all of that geometry. Maybe we'll control minus to drop it back a little bit, and then X vertices. Come out of edit mode, go into solid view, and after a moment it loads the textures. And already with minutes of work, I've got a model which works, which looks great, and for the vast majority of purposes would be absolutely fine. There are a few errors. You can see his wing didn't quite sample properly. I could have probably sampled a few more things. And I'm just going to show you a little cheat, if you like, on how to fix some of these things near invisibly. Before we go any further, I'm just going to right click him and say shade smooth. That actually has smoothed it out slightly. If you want to, if you want to further reduce the vertices, so we're down to under 100,000 now, you can add the decimate modifier. So the ratio is currently 1, which means the face count is what it was, 189,000 faces. If I set that to 0.5, you can see we're down to 94,000 faces. So if we have a look at our model and I turn the visibility of this modifier on and off, so that's with it off, that's with it on, and there really is only a subtle difference. It will vary. Sometimes you'll start to see some sort of glitches in certain areas when you use this. So let's go down even lower than that. So let's go to 0.25. So a quarter. So we're now down to 47,000 faces, only 23,000 vertices. And if you have a look at that area and I turn this off, you can see we're actually starting to get a less pleasing result now. Now that is fixable. We can stretch and move things around. And of course, if you're looking at it from a distance, you probably won't really see that sort of thing anyway. But I'm just going to remove that now. And we've got a little knobble here where obviously some of the background has been added in as geometry. So I'm just going to call up the UV editor. We'll go into edit mode, and then I'm going to click up here and I'm going to select one of the textures. It's clearly created two textures or two texture atlases, and that's something worth bearing in mind. But you can see there's lots of little pieces that are applied. So if we look at materials, this is actually using the 0.001 texture, so we'll go to that one. And there is the texture atlas for this object. Quite fun to sort of look through. It's like a puzzle. Go into edit mode. I'm now going to select these few points, control plus, and just take his little bump off. I'm going to say, I'm just going to look from the other side. I'm going to say X and dissolve faces, and then perhaps just right click and say smooth vertices, and perhaps expand a little bit, right click again, smooth vertices, and you can come down here and increase the number of iterations. There's obviously a problem there, and we're going to deal with that in a minute. So that smoothed the geometry out, but there's a problem with the texture, which might seem like it's quite difficult to fix. Now, if I come back to this area, if I look up here, you may just be able to see if I select it, there is the geometry. So you can see I can scale it up here, and you can even see there's a point up there as well. So that's going to be a bit of a nightmare. You could obviously shrink it and then plonk it over one of these, and with some things that would work fine. But a lot of these photogrammetry models really rely on the texture to make them look how you want them to look. If we come over here and go to texture paint, click the clone tool, press N to bring the right hand menu up and go to tool, and I usually set that a bit smaller to 25. Control left click, and that will put the 3D cursor somewhere, and you will then find you are copying the texture from that area. Now, it won't always work perfectly, and you saw there was a bit of an issue. And if it does that, best thing to do, go back into edit mode and just move this selected geometry somewhere else, because we've got nothing here, for example, and that will make sure it doesn't overwrite any other part of the geometry. Now we're back in texture paint, and I can paint it like that. It won't be perfect, but it will make it much less visible. And I'm going to blend it in a moment as well. You can choose whatever. It's basically sort of 3D version of standard Photoshop tool. You can even press U and just say unwrap. Now it will come out big when you do that, but just scale it down after you've done that. And then you may find that the texture works a little better. Blender struggles a little bit with it. You may need to reposition the cursor a number of times, but this is a good quick and dirty method for just repairing the inevitable errors that will be in the model. And if you want to repair some issues after decimating, you'll need to apply the decimate modifier, but then you can do something like this. And if the geometry is fine and it's just the texture, then that's straightforward. And we can also, of course, smudge and blur. I turn that strength up a little bit just so that it's doing it quick enough so you can see it. It's not a very cooperative tool, but it does work. And now, that has taken away most of that lump that I had there, and relatively speaking, it's invisible and it's got its own little texture. Now, once you've made some changes to your texture, bear in mind, if you just save and close, that's going to vanish. You're going to lose the work you did. The geometry will stay the same, but the new parts of the texture atlas that you've created will disappear. So what you need to do first is you need to come up to here where it says image and say save as, and save it. So I'll just call this one P2, and then go to the shader editor. If you look in here, the default shader that came in with the OBJ model is the one that was there. Now open that and select your modified image. And now, once you've saved it, that will reload when you bring the model back in. So it will use your new texture, and it won't mess up your original texture. That's one of the other important things. So a couple of other little things I did with my texture is roughness comes in at 1, so there's no reflection at all. So I'm going to turn that down quite a bit. I also just added, first of all, color ramp, drop that in there and narrow it in just to pick up on some of the detail. Basically, I want some surface texture that hasn't come with the model itself, but is there in the texture map. It's just finding where that should be, something like that. Perhaps set it to ease or B spline. Once you've done that, I'll pull that out of there. So we've got no texture there at the moment. And then I'm going to add under vector bump node, take the color output and put that into height, and then take the normal output into the normal input. And after a moment, you can see we've got texture, surface texture. It's much too strong at the moment, so we can turn that down quite a long way. And you may find it's the wrong way up, in which case you can just invert it there. You just need to see what looks good. Smaller is generally better. You don't want a lot of it. And finally, what I typically do is just to add some procedural texture to it as well. I'm going to add texture, which is a noise texture. We'll connect the factor of that into displacement. I'm going to add under converter a math node, drop that in there, set that to multiply. For some reason, displacement does cause Blender to slow down a lot just lately. They've obviously modified how displacement works. And I'll set this to a small value. We'll go for 0.025 for the moment, and then set the scale to something like 150. And the value's still too large, so we'll go for 0.001. And that just gives a rough surface detail across the whole thing. And you can see it actually makes it look better. And now I'm just going to take the texture map back in. And even in preview mode, you can see that's looking quite good. You obviously have an open bottom here, but you can close that up easy enough. And if I just add an area lamp, set the background to black, and we'll go into rendered view. And there is our dragon. And that really is all there is to it. I will upload some of this for my Patreon subscribers to use in any way they want to. If you're interested in this, or if you've got any questions about it, just want to ask me about it, just want to tell me about your photogrammetry, I'm very interested to hear what fun you're having with it. Something worth noting is there's three little hashtags below each of my videos now. And if you click on one of those, then you can go and see either some more of my videos or you can see other videos that are related to the subject of mine. So I hope you enjoyed that tutorial. If you did, don't forget to click like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.